Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another WrestleMania review for your boy Deluxe Man's WrestleMania review series. Today we look at WrestleMania 22, and you should know something. I remember not liking this show, or maybe not hating it or not liking it, maybe just being underwhelmed. Maybe that's a better way to describe it. I wasn't all that impressed with the show. Looking back on it, I don't know why I didn't like it. I don't know why I wasn't impressed. Well, maybe it has something to do with the main event, and I'll get to that in a second. But after rewatching it, I don't know what my deal was. I don't know what my problem was, because WrestleMania 22 is a good show. Damn good show. There were a lot of great matches here. Nothing, I wouldn't say anything other than the Edge and Mick Foley match was A quality. Everything else was B and below. But of course, the Edge versus Mick Foley hardcore match. One of the best WrestleMania matches. Period. That was amazing. And looking back and watching it, it's one of the reasons why I'm glad I'm doing this. I'm glad I'm going back and watching these WrestleMania matches, because I'm reminding myself of the great things, of the amazing matches that made me a wrestling fan, or made me stay a wrestling fan this long. So it's always good to do this for me, for you guys. And if you guys are taking this trip with me, I hope you're enjoying yourself, because this is fun. I'm having a great time going back and watching these shows. But WrestleMania 22 is a prime example of another reason why I do this. So I can go back with fresher eyes and appreciate what I didn't appreciate back then. Because like I said, I wasn't the biggest fan of WrestleMania 22. But watching it now with my eyes, it's a damn good show. So let's talk about a couple of things. Both brands, because we're still doing the brand split at this time. Both Raw and SmackDown swapped their world championships. So the World Heavyweight Championship that was on Raw is now on SmackDown, while the WWE Undisputed Championship went to Raw, and then it became the WWE Championship, because that's how they did things. By the way, This is the first appearance of John Cena's spinner belt at WrestleMania. Our favorite championship design. Jesus Christ. I guess for me, I got sick of what he represented later on down the line. Like, here in 2006, it's not a big deal. As a matter of fact, it's pretty cool. It's what it represents as time goes by. And that's what makes fans hate the spinner belt. I'll get much more into detail later for the WrestleManias, because this belt isn't going anywhere. This is WrestleMania what? This is WrestleMania 22. When does that belt change? When do they get a new belt? WrestleMania 29? Yeah. We're stuck with this spinner belt for 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29. 7 more years. Get used to it. Get used to looking back at that spinner belt that you all love. Oh, ladies and gentlemen. All right, let's go ahead and get into the show. We open up with Michelle Williams. Some of you just went, who the hell is Michelle Williams? She's that third wheel in Destiny's Child. You know, the group with Beyonce. Some of you went, oh, I know Beyonce. I also know Kelly. But who's Michelle? Look, in all seriousness, Michelle did a great job singing America the Beautiful. I actually liked her rendition of the song. So, good on her. The show is 4 hours, which is fine. Like I said, I'm not too bothered by 4 hours as long as there's a reason for the 4 hours. And the show was good enough to hold my attention for 4 hours. The date, April 2nd, 2006. The arena, the Allstate Arena in Chicago, Illinois. Yeah. The Chicago crowd, and they were in full swing tonight. The crowd, this is the kind of crowd WWE hates. They loved the heels. And when I mean the heels, I mean Carlito, Chris Masters, Mickie James, Triple H, they all got love. And the babyfaces got booed. Trish got booed. John Cena definitely got booed. And as I go throughout the show, I'll tell you who else got booed. But for the most part, Chicago was in full swing. These are the kind of crowds WWE hates. Attendance, 17,159. Commentary, Joey Styles. He made his first and only, if I'm not mistaken, his only appearance. No, he does make a few more appearances. Because he's at WrestleMania 23 next year. I'm not too sure. We'll see. But it's his first appearance at WrestleMania. Jim Ross, Jared the King Lawler, Michael Cole and Tazz are also on hand. You know who talks about which brand because you've been watching. Now, I think if I'm not mistaken, this is Taz's last appearance as a SmackDown announcer. Because next year we do the ECW, not the WCW brand. Yeah, right. The ECW brand. And Taz and Joey Styles lead that brand. While Michael Cole and JBL lead SmackDown. So, you should know that. Ring announcers Lillian Garcia and Howard Finkel. Interviewers Jonathan Coachman, Josh Mathews, and Todd Grisham. Who the hell is Todd Grisham? Don't worry about it. Let's get into the show. First match was a Raw WWE Tag Team Championship match. Kane and Big Show, who are the tag team champions, that's one hell of a tag team. May 19th. If you got that reference, we can be friends. Carlito and Chris Masters were their opponents. Solid match. It's a nice mix of veterans working with the younger talent. I enjoyed it. Look, despite Masters and Carlito being heels, I thought they were really cool. I thought Carlito, and I still think Carlito, is one of the most underutilized performers in that company. They brought him in strong. I mean, goddamn, his debuts on Raw and SmackDown were him winning championships. SmackDown, in his debut, he won the U.S. Championship off of John Cena and took away the U.S. spinner belt, only to lose it back to him. Anyways, on Raw, he won the IC Championship. They brought him in strong, but after that, he did nothing else. I don't get it. I don't know what happened. I think he had some issues with creative or just the company as it is, and they just stopped pushing him. And Chris Masters was also brought in pretty strong, and they just stopped pushing him too. I don't get it. I thought Chris Masters was awesome. Love the Master Lock. But yeah, these are two talents. I kind of feel like WWE, I won't say dropped the ball with. Well, maybe they did. Yeah, I'm kind of leaning towards it. For now, I'll just say they didn't flesh out or use to their best capacities. Let's go with that. Big Show and Kane keep the championship belts. We go on to the second, number two, Money in the Bank ladder match. The contestants, Matt Hardy, Finley, my name is Finley, and I love to fight. Rob Van Dam, Bobby Lashley, that's my Texan accent coming out. Bobby Lashley, the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, oh Jesus Christ, this old man in this ladder match. And Shelton Benjamin. Great match. Nowhere near as good as the first match, which was a classic, but still a great match. I will say this. As you guys know, the star of the show, as always for any Money in the Bank match, is Shelton Benjamin. He just stole it. Everything he did was amazing. From that ladder run dive to the outside, to him doing a Spider-Man jump. This is a Spider-Man jump from the, I think it was from the ropes, up to the top of the ladder. It was freaking awesome. I don't know how he does this stuff. But to me, another highlight was Rob Van Dam. He did a freaking Van Terminator off the top rope and knocked off Lashley. Yeah, he knocked Lashley off the ladder. And then, of course, he did a 5-star frog splash off the top of the ladder, which never gets old. So RVD goes on to win the briefcase. I was going to say championship. But that is true. He goes on to cash in the briefcase at ECW One Night Stand 2 and finally become a WWE World Champion. Finally. I'll get more into detail about what else happened in that match after the main event. But great Money in the Bank ladder match, absolutely. We have a United States Championship match. Chris Benoit, the champion, took on John Bradshaw Layfield with Jillian Hall, who wasn't necessarily singing yet. Yeah, now you want me, but she had the mole on her face. Well, no. Not this time. I think, no, she still has the mole on her face. She stuck the mole on her face, and then Boogeyman eventually eats it. Don't ask. Let's just move on. The winner is JBL. He is the new U.S. champion. I like how Chris Benoit beats JBL's protege to get the U.S. belt, and then JBL beat him for that belt. But credit where credit is due. Solid match. Nothing else to say. I just kind of knew JBL was going to win because of his gimmick. He was calling himself the real American hero. So it's kind of apropos that he wins the U.S. championship. Simple as that. Match of the night is next. With Joey Styles on commentary, we got a hardcore match between Edge and Mick Foley. You goddamn right it was a classic. Let's see. Why was it a classic? Let's see what this had. We had barbed wire. We had a barbed wire bat. We had chairs. We had frying pans. We had flesh being shedded off skin, including Edge when he speared Mick Foley with barbed wire around his waist. Shedded the skin of Edge's arm. Blood, thumbtacks, a barbed-wired Mr. Sacco, and a flaming table spot where Edge spears Mick Foley through it. Not to mention Joey Styles going, "Oh my God!" Yeah, I think I'm confident in saying this is a classic. Perhaps the greatest hardcore match in WrestleMania history. Yeah, it is the greatest hardcore match in WrestleMania history. What other hardcore match do you know is better than this? Exactly. Edge was on fire. Literally and figuratively on fire during this time. Because every match, every promo, every segment he touched was great. Hell, he was so good as a heel. He was so hot, red hot as a heel. Of course, he was still riding off of the feud with him and Matt from last year, one of the greatest feuds of all time. But he was so red hot at this time, he made the fans hate Lita. Now look, Lita away from Edge is hard to hate. You can't hate Lita away from Edge. Lita with Edge, well, Lita as Edge's sex slave, was very easy to hate. And a lot of the heat she got was because she cheated on Matt Hardy as well, so that kind of helped, but I'm going to assume a lot of that was because she was with Edge, and we couldn't have Lita because she was with Edge. And she did some work here, too. She took a very nasty spot where Mick Foley shoved a barbed wire Mr. Sacco into her mouth and she bled. So she really helped out this match. But the scene, the shot of Edge spearing Mick Foley through a flaming table, one of the greatest moments in WrestleMania history, period. And this is one of the best bouts in WrestleMania history. I rank it up there with some of the best. I don't care what anybody says. This was awesome. All three participants did a great job. And definitely, like I said, the match of the night. Mick Foley at this time was just here to put people over. And that's what he did in 2006. He was there to put Edge over, and he even joined up with Edge for a short time as a heel. He turned heel to help put Edge over. I thought that was great. You don't see that a lot from Mick Foley. He used, I wouldn't even say sacrifice, but he used his status to help out Edge, which I thought was good. What wasn't good at all was this next match. The Boogeyman versus Booker T with Charmel. So, before he became King Booker, I think we see King Booker next year's WrestleMania. I'm not too sure about that, but we'll see. But before he became King Booker, he took on the Boogeyman. Boogeyman. Look, I appreciate what the Boogeyman is as a character. As a comedy act. But as a wrestler, around this time, he sucked. Horrible inside the ring. Very green. And Booker T tried. He tried his best to have a good match with him, but it didn't work out. You couldn't even get me to rewatch this match. When the best part of the match is the worms. Seriously. Seeing him eat the worms and seeing him chase off Charmel with the worms. When that's the best part of this match, we're in trouble. We are in trouble when worms are the best part. Let's move on to one of my favorite parts of this show. Next up is the Women's Championship match. And for the life of me, and I will put this up for anything, I don't care what anybody says, this to me is the best WrestleMania feud for female talent ever. This is the best Women's Championship match in WrestleMania history. This is the best feud. This is the best for anything involving female wrestling when it comes to WrestleMania. And Trish Stratus and Mickie James did some fantastic work building into this match. It's just a great feud, man. Mickie James came in for her debut at WrestleMania as a fan-turned-obsessed lover for Trish Stratus. And I would just watch the video package before this because the video package does an excellent job of highlighting all the psychotic moments that took place. With, what, a six-month build? It had to at least been 6 months. 6 months, yeah. It included Trish Stratus being kissed by Mickie James under the mistletoe, Mickie James dressing up as Trish Stratus, Mickie James framing Trish Stratus' boyfriend and sending him to jail, a bloody nose Mickie James kidnapping Ashley Massaro, knocking out Trish and kissing her with a bloody nose, even a scene of her in her shrine room, and it's a shrine room of Trish Stratus, pictures on the wall and all that, candles lit, and it's some of the creepiest scenery to ever take place. And you know who deserves credit? You know who deserves credit for all of this. Mickie James. Psycho Mickie, as a character, as a performer, was some of the best work I've seen from any female talent in WWE. By the way, you should know this. Mickie James came up with everything involving the storyline. The storyline was pitched by Mickie James herself. And Vince McMahon said, yeah, it's a great idea. Man, all of this was awesome. The story of this entire match was amazing, including those skirts. Those skirts by Mickie were woo! Yes, sir. Mickie was amazing in more ways than one. It should be said that Trish Stratus was a six-time women's champion at this point. She won a lot of championship belts. The match itself was great. Great match. I'm not going to say it was amazing or a classic. Because the one thing that hurt this match was the ending. I thought the ending was kind of abrupt. She just fell on her knee and kicked her and she won the championship. So I felt like if it had a stronger finish, I would have absolutely given it an A. But it just missed the mark of being an amazing match. But it's still a great match. I mean, Mickie, I'm telling you, man. The acting, the moves, the selling, everything that she did in this match won me over. I became a huge Mickie James fan because of this match. And Trish was great. I'm not taking anything away from Trish. But I'm sorry, Trish. Mickie was the highlight of this match. She won the crowd over. Like I said, the crowd was cheering on the heels, but it's kind of hard to hate Mickie James here. She was amazing. And I wish she would go back to this Mickie James. By the way, the version I had still had the vajayjay finger lick. So, I know it gets edited out, especially on the network. It's edited out on the network. But the version I watched had the vajayjay finger lick. Score. So, yeah, great match. Mickie James wins and becomes the women's champion for the first time. It's good to know, although Trish Stratus retires this year, like, completely retires from wrestling and wins her 7th women's championship as a result, Mickie James becomes the centerfold of that division for a long time. I think until she leaves until 2010? Yeah, she lives in 2010, and she's pretty much the centerfold of that division until then. Now, Lita, I also think, leaves, right? She does leave. Does she leave this year? Yeah, she does leave this year. She also leaves. She doesn't stick around. So, it's all Mickie James after this. Sweet. Love Mickie. Can't go wrong with Mickie James. WrestleMania streak match number 14. It's a casket match involving The Undertaker, the dead man himself, taking on the world's strongest man, Mark Henry. So, during this time, Mark Henry was the silverback. And, look, nothing beats the Hall of Pain. But he was pretty okay. I mean, they gave him a strong push. As a performer, I liked him. I didn't think he was horrible, but, you know, it wasn't one of those things that was lighting the world on fire, if I'm going to be honest with you. He was still living off the momentum he got from putting Batista on the shelf. And the heat he was carrying from that, he would continue to carry until he fights Batista when he does come back. Now, Batista was on the show, but like I said in my last review, he doesn't have a match because he's injured. He appeared for like 5 seconds, and that was it. The match itself, average. Not a horrible match, but nothing great. very by the numbers. The only good thing about this match was that amazing dive over the top rope and over the casket that he did. Taker did an amazing dive to the outside. He flew over the casket and then landed on Mark Henry. That was awesome. Other than that, very forgettable match. Now, this is a match I am happy I went back and watched. No holds barred, Shawn Michaels versus Vincent Kennedy McMahon. The feud was amazing. This was an amazing freaking feud. And it started over Shawn Michaels telling Vince McMahon to forget about Bret Hart. Now, Bret Hart, after being screwed over 1997, Montreal screw job, he does openly come back and get accepted into the Hall of Fame. And he tells the world, look, you don't have to be upset. You don't have to hold a grudge against Shawn Michaels or Vince McMahon or WWE anymore. I'm good. It's all done. A great way to wrap up his career. However, Vince McMahon didn't forgive Bret Hart. And Shawn Michaels told Vince, let it go. Let it go led to 3 months of hell for Shawn Michaels. And he made Shawn Michaels do some of the craziest, unrelenting, embarrassing things that you could imagine. Shawn Michaels had to pee in a freaking cup. He had to pee in a freaking cup. He had to kiss Vince McMahon's behind. All that stuff. He made Shawn's life a living hell. And it built up to Shawn Michaels basically, I wouldn't even call it a squash match, but it was all Shawn Michaels getting his revenge. That's what it was. Shawn Michaels beats up everybody. The Spirit Squad, Shane McMahon, and Vince McMahon. They got their butts kicked. Big time. No pun intended, you know, that's the slogan of the show. Anyways, this got... let me see how small. That much offense. Can you see it? That much offense on Shawn Michaels. And Shawn Michaels just dominated him. We got the classic ladder dive where Shawn Michaels hits the ladder elbow drop. I think the ladder was like... They said it was over 20 feet tall. It was a large, large ladder. And we also got the little DX sign that signified or teased anything, if anything else, that DX was coming back this year. Shawn Michaels beats Vince McMahon, and then we got the shot of Vince McMahon flipping off the... He was flipping off the audience while being carried away on a stretcher. That was priceless. That was great. The feud is not over with, because, like I said, we do get the return of DX, and we continue the feud with the McMahons. We have the SmackDown World Heavyweight Championship match. Kurt Angle, the champion, versus Randy Orton versus the Royal Rumble winner, Rey Mysterio. A lot of people say Rey Mysterio got the spot because he's a friend of Eddie Guerrero. To which I say, some of that's true, but most of it I can't really agree with. Listen, if this was about Eddie Guerrero and a family getting that spot, Chavo would have gotten the spot. Rey Mysterio got this spot because he was a main event player. He earned the spot. Like I said, that feud with Eddie Guerrero launched him into the main event scene. He was one of the biggest merchandise sellers. He was one of the biggest players. He was one of the best wrestlers. I'm sorry, some of you are saying that Rey Mysterio doesn't deserve the spot. I disagree. I think he earned it. Now, the championship run, I'll be real with you and say it wasn't all that good. But the victory and the match was great. Hell of a match. Like I said, the only problem with this match, the ending was kind of abrupt. It was... I don't know. Maybe it was... I won't say the ending was abrupt. Maybe it was because the match was too short. I'm not too sure what the issue was. Maybe the match was too short. Maybe the ending could have been done better. There was something missing. It didn't really feel like an A-plus classic. It was a great match, but it wasn't a classic. It was still very entertaining. And a great title victory for Rey Mysterio. And I'm happy for him. I'm happy he got this. I don't care what anybody says. You can say all you want that he only got the championship because of Eddie Guerrero. And that might be somewhat true. But to say it was all because of Eddie is a lie. Because if it was all because of Eddie, or if it was all for Eddie, Chavo would have got the spot. He didn't. So, yeah. Congratulations, Rey Mysterio. Great match. Great triple threat for the World Heavyweight Championship. We got a... What is it called? A pillow fight? No, a Playboy Bunny pillow fight. The first one ever between Trish Stratus and Mickie James. That would have been amazing. The feud they were having? That would have been very interesting. No, it was against Candice Michelle and Tori Wilson. Look, I'll be real with you. This wasn't as satisfying as the other softcore porn moments we've gotten at WrestleMania. Honestly, I thought Mickie James and Trish Stratus satisfied me more. Mm-hmm. Next is the main event. Let me just end this before this gets creepy. So, the WWE Championship, John Cena and Triple H. Let me just stop for a minute and talk about the John Cena hate. So, around this time, Cena was getting showered with boos everywhere he went. The John Cena hate was very apparent. And what bothers me about this match, a lot of people remember it more for the Cena hate than the quality of the match. They remember it more for the Chicago crowd completely crapping on John Cena. And Chicago would not let up. They wanted WWE to know they hated John Cena. And they refused to stop showing them that they hated John Cena. But here's what I'm going to say. When it comes to John Cena and Triple H, if you ignore the chance, if you ignore the crowd, this was a great match. It was a great match. Every punch, every hold, every suplex, and every move had a reaction. And honestly, it was kind of refreshing. It's kind of cool seeing everything done in a match get a reaction. It was pretty cool. I was shocked to see Triple H lose to tap out. Lose to a submission. Maybe I should say it that way. Lose by tap out. That's what I wanted to say. But it was shocking seeing him lose by tap out, because that rarely happens. Now, Chris Benoit, okay. Kurt Angle, okay. But John Cena? That weak STFU at the time, not STF, it's STFU, was... I don't know how I feel about that, but regardless, they delivered. It was a great match. And I guess for me, personally, the reason why, and the more I think about it, the more I talk about it, I think I know why I didn't like this show as much. Because at the time, I was a John Cena fan. I loved John Cena in 2006. That was the last year I loved him, though. Regardless, I wasn't very happy with the hate he got. I thought it was BS. Just pointless, groundless hate for John Cena. Looking back on it, I have to say it's still the same feeling. I think in 2006, there was really no reason to hate John Cena. 2007 is a different story. But 2006, why are y'all booing Cena? Why? He's entertaining. He's great. No, he's not the greatest wrestler in the world, but I'm sorry. I've seen worse. So, I don't understand the heat that Cena got. And he had a great match. It wasn't like the match sucked. It was a great match. Anyway, Cena goes on to fight RVD at One Night Stand 2, like I said, and loses the belt to RVD. Trust me, if you thought Chicago was mean to Cena, you haven't seen anything until you see how mean and awful that ECW crowd was to Cena at One Night Stand 2. They were mean. Like, death sentence, watch out, Cena, they're gonna come for your ass, mean. Jesus, it's rough. I mean, going back and watching it now, I'm okay with it, but back then, I hated it. I hated the heat he got. Triple H goes on to reform DX, D-Generation X, with Shawn Michaels, and they have an awesome second run working with the McMahons. I would put it on par with their first run. Yeah, their first run and this run were about as good. Favorite moment was Triple H and Shawn Michaels impersonating the McMahons. That McMahon parody is some of the greatest comedy WWE has done. I love it. Go watch it if you haven't seen it. So overall, damn good show. Damn good show. But that's my opinion. How do you feel about it down below in the comments? Next time we look at 23 and 24. Alright, and after 20, I think 25 is when we get those WrestleManias. Can't wait to talk about those. Thank you guys for watching my WrestleMania review series. I'll catch you guys next time. Into X-Man's World. I'm signing out. Peace.